to order. Welcome all. First item on tonight's agenda is minutes of the previous meeting of October 17th, 1995. Okay. Any comments or corrections from the board?
I move the minutes accepted as written.
Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Thank you. Next item on this evening's agenda is correspondence. We have several items, any of which of you that would like to see them, they're all available in the town planner's office. First item is a letter from CMP regarding the Perez Nabuck Land Associates subdivision. Second correspondence is a letter to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board from Joanna and Corey Morrissey discussing issues related to the subdivision and abutters' concerns. A similar letter has been received from Jane E. Greer. And lastly, a letter from Ellen Muger and Robert Clements. Again, for the public record, there is no formal application regarding the subdivision in front of the planning board. We've had several workshop sessions, which does not provide any legal standing for the project, but simply conveys information to the board and to the abutters early on in the process. It occurred to me in reviewing this information, however, that there are a lot of abutters' concerns that are being raised, whether in favor of or against or with other issues related, and perhaps it's appropriate to somehow keep a running file of public comments, which I believe the town planner is doing. So those will be available to us should and when a formal application come before the board. Next item is a letter from the fire chief to town planner Maureen O'Meara regarding main wireless tower application, stating that there's no adverse effect regarding the turning capability of the ladder truck. The next item is a letter from Michael Hill, town attorney, regarding main wireless application, specifically two questions that were raised by the planning board at the last meeting. I suggest that we just simply put that letter aside until we get to that item on this evening's agenda. Next letter, again, is from the town attorney to Maureen O'Meara and is responding to questions that were raised with respect to impact fees for educational facilities. And I would suggest with this item that we refer it to a planning board workshop. Is there anything with respect to this that's happening with the ZORC committee at this time? And just to point out, there's no existing ordinance that enables the planning board to levy an impact fee for educational impacts, and that is something that has to come from the town council.
Mr. Chairman, it was unclear to me, and I don't want to take a lot of time, but is that for all, that it just, there is no ordinance under which this planning board can levy any impact fee at all, regardless of whether it's educational facility or infrastructure?
I think there are cases when you could impose some kind of, not an impact fee, but a fee in lieu of provision of services.
But it clearly points to a hole in the ordinance that may be there for one reason or another. But I think it warrants further discussion at a workshop meeting to see if it's a concern that the board might have and if it's appropriate to forward those concerns to the town council for action.
I think it is. We reviewed that issue probably in 1989, maybe even before then. But and the council wasn't interested in handling that. They may be now. I mean, that was still back in the days of controlling growth through two-acre lots and septic systems.
Okay. The next item of correspondence is a letter from the town manager regarding the Highlands subdivision and the performance guarantee. Suggests that we put that aside until we get to that agenda item. We also have an interesting letter here from the Code Enforcement Administrator, Gerald E. Daigle, regarding performance guarantees for site plan review and public access. And again, I think we should refer this to a planning board, put this on a planning board workshop agenda. In summary, what he's stating is that he's suggesting that it would be appropriate to have a, some sort of a certificate or guarantee bond for all site plan and public access waivers as a way of enforcing the plan that's approved. Next item is Planning Commissioner's Fall Journal. Interestingly enough, for anyone who wants to read about Robert's Rules of Order, it's well documented in here and gives some good examples. Fast food restaurant design, which also not only points to the typical restaurants, but also references McDonald's and custom buildings such as the one up in Freeport. We have zoning news dated October regarding planning for hillside development, very appropriate to some of the applications we receive in this community. And a takings art, a takings article from the Maine Association of Planners. I have not read that in detail, but I would suggest that that's probably a good one to put on the planning board workshop agenda as well. And lastly, under zoning news, shedding light on the urban landscape. Maine is really at the forefront with respect, perhaps not with actual guidelines, but certainly it has a state law that requires that all new lighting provide a cutoff so that the light does not get spilled above the horizontal. And that was primarily as a move from somebody who was a resident of Kennebunk, who was an astronomer, and was concerned about issues of light spillage and being able to see out to the heavens. That's an extra copy. First item, additional items that we have is we have a letter from the Conservation Commission regarding the Highlands, pointing out perhaps a discrepancy in the wetland calculations with respect to the waterline crossings. I think we should put that in our packet for the Highlands subdivision. Also, at the desk this evening are photographs provided with a letter from Richard Sullivan. Again, this is regarding the Highlands subdivision. Now that will become part of the public record. We have a letter from the planning to the town council and the Zork committee and the planning board regarding a Zork update on scenic protection scheduled for Monday, November 27th at 7:30 at town hall. We have two letters from Douglas Edwards from Maine Wireless regarding right title and interest and something else that I haven't had an opportunity to read, but we'll be getting to that item under the second item under new business. Are there any other correspondence, phone calls, letters at home? Okay, let's press ahead then to new business. I'm remiss. We have received a letter under correspondence from Stephen Moore, landscape architect representing Peter Kennedy on the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision, requesting that their application be tabled tonight without discussion. And we'll deal with that issue under new business. First item on tonight's agenda is a Highland subdivision amendment. There was a completeness meeting held a month ago, and tonight's meeting was scheduled for a public hearing for amended site subdivision application and a wetlands alteration permit. Perhaps Maureen can bring us up to speed here in terms of the standing of the project and how we should proceed given the letter that we've received from the applicant's representative.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman. Are we going to have any discussion about this project at all? If so, I need to step down now.
I would say, yes, we will have a motion, so there will be some discussion.
Okay. As in the past, I will excuse myself for this item.
Okay.
Peter Kennedy came before the town last month and requested amendments. Peter Kennedy came to the town last month, to the planning board, and requested amendments to a previously approved Highland subdivision at Broad Cove. He specifically was asking for relocation of the water line from the emergency access road connecting to Winding Way to instead extend down the emergency access road and connect to Hunts Point Road. He also wanted to lengthen the length of the gravel road, decrease the amount of pavement on the emergency access road, and also change the access for Lot 5 from Winding Way to from Two Lights Road. The board deemed the application complete at the last meeting conditionally and scheduled a public hearing for this meeting. The applicant has requested in writing that they be tabled from this meeting in order to take the time to try to resolve some of the issues that have been raised from the staff review. Are there any questions?
In terms of procedure, since they are on the agenda and they've been asked to be taken off the agenda without discussion, that's difficult to do in order to get them off the agenda. I believe we have to have discussion. The public has been notified, and obviously there are many members of the public here this evening. The board can proceed, I believe, in a couple of ways, but I think it would be perhaps at best unfair to proceed as if the applicant were here. The applicant has clearly requested that the application be tabled, with the understanding, of course, that it's a voluntary tabling of the application. In no way does our time to review this project get affected by the fact that the applicant has requested to have this application tabled. There are, for anyone who does see this letter and for the public record, there are many items in here regarding, or comments regarding, staff review, and I think that the concerns that were raised by the board at the last meeting with respect to completeness and other issues and complexities of the project relate directly to that issue. And I guess I won't say any more on that issue. I would suggest that it would be appropriate that there are members of the public here this evening, that we perhaps discuss this enough to have a motion for tabling if the board so decides to table it, and otherwise give the public the opportunity, since this project has been noticed, to express any concerns in favor or against the project that will be taken as note, but this will not be the formal public hearing of record for this project, that assuming that the applicant comes before us once again, the public hearing will be re-advertised and re-noticed, and at that point, we will have the formal public hearing. Does the board agree with that? Mr. Edsall?
I was just going to say, I think, even though the members of the public here, I think it's most fair also to them that the applicant be here to respond to questions or comments. So I think we should just simply, without discussion, offer a motion anyway. The motion's a big discussion, but both the table and to reschedule the public hearing.
I guess I agree. Any other discussion by the board with respect to Steve's comment?
No.
I guess I agree, Steve, with that, with the exception that this is a fax transmittal and was dated today's date, and nobody has been notified otherwise about tonight's public hearing until they took the time to come here this evening and find out. I'm assuming that most people who are here are abutters that live in town. There are occasions when people travel from out of town for public hearings. I guess what I'd do is poll the audience and see if there's anyone who would wish to speak this evening or whether they'd prefer to wait until another, until the formal public hearing is rescheduled. Is there any member of the public who would like to speak this evening on this matter?
Okay. When you're going to reschedule it for?
Do we know?
Yeah, it would be the regular meeting, and barring any request by the applicant to table it again, it would be the regular meeting in December, which I believe is December 19th.
I would like to make some comments, because I'm not going to be in town.
Okay. I think although the applicant has asked for no discussion on this item, I think there's not a problem with tabling it. I think out of courtesy to the public and recognizing that it's an informal public hearing, that if you wish to make a comment, please raise your hand and go to the podium and introduce yourself. I would say that it would be in essence the same as writing a letter and having the letter on file with the town planner, but it won't be part of a public hearing record.
Mr. Chair, I don't know that there's anything, such thing as an informal public hearing, but I might make a suggestion that if the board chooses to open up the public hearing, then we simply not close the public hearing, just continue it a month, so that we don't have to repost for another public hearing.
Very good idea.
I guess the concern I have with that is that all the people that may want to be involved in the public hearing are not here this evening, and somehow the public has to know that this meeting, the item was tabled and that the public hearing is continued to the next meeting. Is that an unusually...
The board could open a public hearing at this meeting and just not close it, and I would still send probably another notice out to everyone letting them know. The one problem we've had in the past is that sometimes people are less than perfectly happy if they are forced to comment on a project that, where all the information that may not be in yet.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only concern you would have with holding the public hearing now.
Let me ask you another question, and I guess I'm not suggesting, I hadn't thought of it as a public hearing. I thought it as a courtesy to the people who'd come to tonight to make comment. But since we have a pending application here, we don't have that luxury of that informality, so we would have to open the public hearing. The other issue, does it provide any additional standing to the applicant that they wouldn't otherwise had the public hearing been completely tabled until the next meeting?
The standing for the applicant is granted once you deem the application complete.
Let me rephrase the question. Would the application have to be processed to review or approved or denied by the planning board in a shorter time period because we in fact opened a public hearing at this evening's meeting rather than tabling it until next meeting?
You have the option to table an application at this meeting regardless of what request the applicant has. You have 60 days from the day you deem it complete.
So the answer to Tom's question is no. It makes no difference
makes
whether
no difference.
The public hearing is begun tonight.
Okay. I guess with that, I would, unless the board has any other questions or comments, suggest that we open a public hearing for any members of the public who would like to come up and speak in favor, against, or otherwise about the project.
And I guess I would say in particular, I would certainly urge that to be done, but especially because, as I understand, we're on the air. If the only concern I would have would be that the applicant was somehow prejudiced by not being able to hear what has been said by the public to us, but because we don't have to worry about that since we're on the air anyway, if the applicant wished to review the proceedings, certainly could, and I see no reason whatsoever not to go forward.
Mr. Chairman, I agree with that, and even though I first initially said that it's most fair that all parties be here, I think this is unusual in that we received a fax transmission after 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the day of a meeting.
I agree.
And in fairness to people, public who may have showed up, I think we can proceed with that.
What we would normally do in this situation, we would have the applicant make a brief presentation regarding the project and advise us of any changes or revisions since the last meeting. Obviously, the applicant isn't here, and the applicant has requested to be tabled. It's not either the planning board or the town planner's responsibility to make a presentation on behalf of the applicant, so there'll be no presentation of the project at this evening's meeting. We'll just simply open it up for public comment. With that, is there anyone who would like to address the planning board? The gentleman in the back.
My name is Clint Pierce. I live at 74 Hunts Point Road. My home and land abuts Peter Kennedy's land and the proposed waterline access. It's basically, let's see, it's right here, and here's where he's proposing waterline access.
I'm sorry, which lot is yours?
We're right there.
Mm-hmm.
I've watched the development or lack of the development of the Highland subdivision over the last 4 years, and I'm not the type of person to try and keep someone from developing what is rightly their own. I've had family that has not been allowed to develop property, and I personally don't think it's fair for state or local government to have such controls over landowners. However, I do believe that there should be strict rules and regulations followed by developers, and it is up to the local and state government to ensure that taxpayers and members of the community are protected from developers that don't follow through on proposed plans and development. The area behind our home has been destroyed for almost 2 years now, and we have seen no change. From my observations, the wetlands area has been greatly affected by the project. If the need to save money is the primary reason for the waterline change, I really believe that Peter Kennedy owes it to our community to clean up some of the other parts of the project first, before he's allowed to start impacting other areas of our neighborhood. The access to the new road off of Winding Way has been a mess for a very long time, and nothing has been done about it. I can't believe the town could allow more development like that to happen before some of the other parts of the project were completed or at least cleaned up. I ask the members of the board to seriously think about what will be done next and if it really will make a difference to the project to disturb more wetlands. Looking at the possible access areas of the development, I can't believe there isn't a waterline connection from an existing area that has already been impacted by the project. I don't know all the facts about the project or Peter Kennedy as a developer. All I know is what I've seen so far, and really don't want to look at the same thing the people along Winding Way have had to look at for a very long time. I do think something should be done about the entire project, and if anything, the town should be developing stricter guidelines on having developers adhere to project completion schedules. It really doesn't bother me at all that there may someday be new homes behind our house. What does bother me is that at this rate, it may take 10 years for it to happen. It's been almost already 5. And I guess the one question I have is I really don't understand why he's not trying to access from either here or here, and why it's necessary to go through this area again. I mean, if I'm sure all of you have been down in this area, you've seen what it looks like, and my greatest concern is that the same thing's going to happen here, and it really, I mean, it's been forever, and you all know that. I would really have to say, I mean, if something was going to be done there at all, he would really have to stick to a time frame, and also landscaping, and let alone the fact that the wetlands have been really so affected by this already. I mean, I was back there the other day, and it really is, I mean, it's a mess, and it's been a very long time that this has happened. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other members of the public? Yes, sir. Green sweater.
My name is Dan Boxer, and I really appreciate the comments of Mr. Pierce, because he was really speaking mainly about me. I'm the fellow in Winding Way, along with the rest of my family, right here, who for I don't know how many years, at least it seems like a lot of years, there's been a couple anyway, has had to put up basically with a string of unbroken promises and a mess that everybody says, how do you do it? And I don't. We've spoken with the town manager, we've spoken with the code enforcement officer, we've spoken with members of the council, and if any of you people have been by there, about the only relief we got was the broken down, torn and tattered snow fence that would blow over onto my driveway got removed in exchange for some big ugly, they aren't even rocks, they're, I don't know what they are, they're square pieces of something that Mr. Kennedy really put to make sure he didn't have any liability for somebody driving up and down that road. It's a mess, it's an eyesore, and I want to second the comments that were made before, and I don't normally get personal, I won't, I'll talk about the project, but I think with this particular project, you have to have a different standard, and I think you have to have a different approach. Trees were cut, and they've been laying there for 3 years. There's a pile of old metal by the junction box in front of my house that won't be moved. Somehow, whatever you do, you need to make sure that Mr. Kennedy gets the message and does it. And I know that that sounds self-evident, but it just hasn't worked. He really doesn't care about the people in that area, how things look, and what kind of mess he makes. And that translates into the various proposals, because I think there's really only one reason why he's doing anything, and that's from a profit standpoint. And I think you need to look at it very carefully to make sure what you do isn't mainly to make the project more profitable for Mr. Kennedy, but to make the project one that you're proud of and that the neighbors in the area finally get a little bit of relief from. I want to talk specifically about two things in that regard. And incidentally, by way of historical background, I was on this board when that project first came, and I recused myself because I was a neighbor, and I bit my tongue, and there was a lot that I didn't like about it. And I am going to mention a few things today because I think they're relevant to this proposal, and I think it's never too late to fix something since he has made an amendment. As a final just background thing, I want to thank you for what I know you're not very comfortable doing, having a public hearing without the developer here. On the other hand, it doesn't surprise me that this afternoon at 3 o'clock you got sort of a one-way request to do something for his convenience, not thinking that there might be a bunch of people who might have changed plans to be here and might not be able to be here next month. And I really do appreciate that, because I know this is unusual. Two things that I want to comment specifically that I'd ask that you deal with in any final approval, and I'm in the strange position of asking you to approve this thing in some changed fashion so it finally gets done and we get something that we're proud of, not embarrassed of, when people come to see us. First thing is I understand, and we haven't gotten a lot on the project. We were going to get that tonight, but I understand that the road in front of my house, which is this tar road, will be a little bit shorter, and the gravel road will be a little bit longer. One of the things that I never understood when this project was first approved was why we had to have a big, wide, straight, ugly road that was going to serve one, two, or three houses, and now I think we're talking about one or two houses. If you go to the other side of the development, on the Two Lights side, you see this big, straight thing serving a few houses, and it makes no sense. I think it was a sort of a historical artifact of the days when hook and ladders had to be able to do a 360 in the middle of a road and get out of there. I really believe that, and it just doesn't make any sense. And it's going to look idiotic to have a full-size road go down 500 or 700 feet, whatever it is, and stop. I talked to Mike McGovern about this at one time, and I said, why can't we just have sort of a country road serving two or three houses? We have them all over Cape Elizabeth. It's what I think gives us our charm and the beauty of this community, and frankly, about the only scars in the community are when somebody makes a mistake and bows to convenience, and we make a big, straight, wide road somewhere, and everybody says, why'd they do that? Well, I've got one proposed for in front of my house that's going to serve one or two other houses, and I don't think it's ever too late to make that be an attractive, small, in-scale road. I applaud bringing back the gravel, because I think that's a beautiful old dirt farm road, and to the extent you can keep it that way, I would urge you to do so. Got to the point last year where Kennedy was pointing out which trees on my property, the big maples that hang over, would have to be cut to service this thing, which, again, say, just doesn't make any sense. I'm sure the person who buys that lot is going to wonder why they have this big road going a little ways down towards their house. Second, and so I'd ask that you specifically include in your deliberations some effort to make that road be what you would want to serve you if you live down that basically lane, and it dead-ended at one or two houses. We just don't need what's proposed. Secondly, there is a drainage ditch, which you may or may not have seen, which is next to my house. It's right in here, and at the risk of sounding flip, it's one of these things that you probably could see from the moon. It is just huge, and it's a big scar. It has lain in the same state of disrepair as the rest of this project for a number of years. Probably it met somebody's definition of some kind of a suitable drainage, but if you go out there and look, It has to be the least attractive drainage or runoff collection site that any you've ever seen, and it kind of ends in that floppy green sediment catching stuff that blows around in the winter. And I think if you people could include as a condition in any approval that one, that ditch be made attractive in some way that perhaps Maureen or professionals with more knowledge than I could tell you how to sort of restore it so that it's a serviceable, small, attractive thing. And secondly, require that there be some screening because it's just basic scarred earth, and I have no reason to believe that he intends to have it be anything other than what it is. I have no comment because I'm not familiar with the proposal on the other end. So those are my two comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Richard Sullivan, and I live at 72 Two Lights Road, which is an abutter to phase two of Mr. Kennedy's project. And you have my letter, which contains photographs of the wetlands areas through the district areas that Mr. Kennedy wants to put his water lines. And I have some comments in the early part of my letter that are not very flattering to Mr. Kennedy, but I won't bother to read them tonight since he's not here to hear them. And I'll confine my comments to issues of the wetlands. I've been an observer of Mr. Kennedy's project since the beginning, and my main concerns have related to land use and wetlands violations. When Mr. Kennedy first proposed his plan, we hired our own wetlands expert because we felt that his map didn't adequately characterize the terrain, and were able to document that he had omitted a number of wetlands areas from his initial map. Subsequently, the town hired its own wetlands expert to draw up another document because of the documented ambiguity and omissions on Mr. Kennedy's part. His plan was given initial approval as being complete, as I recall, 1 month prior to the passing of a new wetlands ordinance by the town council. So he just barely squeaked in under the old pre-1990 wetlands ordinance. And even using the old ordinance, there were very serious concerns about the wetlands in Mr. Kennedy's project. And a number of questions were raised by the planning board at that time. Ultimately, his plan was approved with reluctance, and actually it was denied on the first vote, and then a revote was taken that night, and the vote and passed reluctantly in some degree because of a threat of legal ramifications to the town. When his plan was subsequently denied by the DEP precisely because of wetlands violations, and the DEP required that he change his road from the proposed link to Hunt's Point and change it to run straight through to Winding Way. Now Mr. Kennedy returns wanting to dig up again in the same wetlands that the DEP had denied him before. This link right through next to Bruce Gaskway's house contains large puddles of water, which are documented in the photographs that you have. And in addition, he wants to make connections from lots 4, 5, and 6 along the easement behind Hunts Point Road, and the residents of that road will tell you, and these photographs document, that there are very large pools, small lakes of water all through that area. Mr. Kennedy now is once again coming before the planning board asking for a wetlands waiver and asking the planning board to sanction even more wetlands violations. His 1990 plan, as approved, has significant wetlands alteration sanctioned. If we applied the 1995 criteria to his project, there are many other areas of wetlands that he will be violating in his approved project. So he's asking us, asking really the planning board a favor to sanction these wetlands alterations to save him money. And I guess my my point is that the planning board doesn't owe Mr. Kennedy any favors at this point in time. He may promise to restore the areas to their former wetlands condition after construction, but based on his record of dealings with the town in the past, these promises are not to be believed. Based on his past actions, he's likely to do the minimum he thinks he can get away with, and if held accountable, complain that he's being treated unfairly and possibly threaten legal action. I therefore urge the planning board not to grant Mr. Kennedy the favor of a wetlands alteration permit. He has already approved to destroy enough wetlands, and the town does not owe him any favors. Past planning boards were powerless to stop his plans. You have the power to say no to more wetlands violations. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public? Yes, in the back.
Good evening, members of the planning board. Would have been here sooner, but without a second access from Broad Cove, it took me a little bit longer to come down here. I've seen a lot of these faces
in
the past. Pardon me?
Tell us who you are.
I'm sorry. I'm Bruce Gasquay. I'm a resident at 82 Hunts Point Road. I'm an abutter to the proposed wetlands alteration, and my neighbor is Clint Pierce. I'd also like to thank Mr. Carlson from the last meeting, although it was not a public hearing. He was gracious enough to ask about my lot and perhaps whether the owner of that lot might be impacted by this proposed amendment to the subdivision. I'm sorry to be here again tonight, and I know you all must be extremely tired of this project, as I am. I think we've been here 5 or 7 years now. It seems inconceivable. Incidentally, I saw Mr. Kennedy Friday at lunch in town at a watering hole. I didn't have lunch with him, but he was there, and he asked me if I was going to be at the meeting and asked me if I needed any additional information about the project and smiled and said, "See you Tuesday night." So, gosh, it's amazing how things can change over a period of time. I'm asking all of you this evening to deny this change in application. This project, as you all know, is an absolute mess, and it gets worse and worse all the time. I don't know what code enforcement is doing about this, but I've heard lots of promises. Originally, the road was put in surreptitiously on a Saturday when code enforcement wasn't around, as was a roundabout up on Phase 2 up on Channelview without permission to do so. After that time, before the applicant was allowed to do any further excavation, he was supposed to restore the wetlands and the altered area to its original vegetation. I would ask anybody to go out there and show me the original vegetation. There's lots of it out there, but most of it's under about 10 tons of dirt right now. I have the Twin Pyramids, Cheops, and whatever the other one is in my backyard. When I look out my window, I see these incredibly high mounds of dirt that were excavated more than 2 years ago. This applicant has not sunk a shovel in a year and a half out there. I went to the town manager, Mike McGovern, in April of 95, this year, and asked him why the town had not called in the bond, performance bond that was taken for phase one. And I was told by Mr. McGovern that he was going to contact Peter Kennedy. And after that time, in June, when the bond was up, Mr. Kennedy was given another 3-month extension, which has now gone on to about 6 months. I can see no reason, like most of my neighbors, Mr. Sullivan, who was just up here, Mr. Boxer, Mr. Pierce, why this gentleman should be granted any favors at this point. The DEP would not allow access into Hunts Point Road for a road because it would have violated wetlands ordinances. I've watched on television as all of you on the planning board have denied people who have lots of budding wetlands who even wish to put an addition on a house because it may disturb wetlands. Why now possibly would you allow Mr. Kennedy to alter wetlands? We have a serviceable road that's been dug up countless times, as Mr. Boxer says. It's an eyesore. If any of you have been down there in the past week, Mr. Boxer now has Lake Wobegon beside his house. You can have Olympic-sized pool in there. I can see no reason why would anyone possibly allow Mr. Kennedy to disturb wetlands. I'm also wondering why the town, who was totally adamant about not having this project go forth unless we had a through road, a second full access into Broad Cove, Mr. McGovern, those were his words, now is going to accept, if you allow this to go forth, a more limited access road with more gravel and less pavement. I know the fire chief supposedly says that's okay, but I'm wondering if the town has any designs at any point in the future of having a second access into Broad Cove. Why would they allow a narrower, less paved road to go forth at this point? Again, I'm getting tired of this. I know you all are getting tired of this. My neighbors are getting tired of this. The town, I believe, has a bond. They have a performance bond to put this project through the way it was proposed finally for phase one. Why is the town not now doing that? Why are they granting this person more favors, more time extensions? I'm not opposed and never been opposed to Mr. Kennedy doing this project. It's his land, and I've never begrudged him that. But we're constantly getting surprises here. It's in a total state of disrepair and dishevelment. I can't imagine that either the DEP, the planning board, or the town itself can favor what's gone on out here and will allow it to go forth. Mr. Kennedy also has another project over near Stroudwater that's in a somewhat similar state of disrepair with nothing ever built on it. Why are we letting this continue? Why aren't we making him adhere to the policy, adhere to the plan that was done more than 2 years ago, and let's get on with it and get it finished. Thank you very much for your time this evening.
Thank you. Any other members of the public who would, yes, sir, the gentleman in the blue shirt.
Good evening. I'm John Chance. I live at 66 Hunts Point Road, directly next to Mr. and Mrs. Pierce. And the lot that we own is this lot here. It's a double lot, and in the central portion of the lot is a easement, a drainage easement that not only drains Hunts Point Road, but also drains a small creek that is across the street from us in another property that I believe Mr. Kennedy owns as well. And in fact, we'll have to be involving wetlands across there, but that's another discussion, I'm sure. The plan, as I understand it, where the new hookup for plumbing and the water access will be directly behind the Pierces, my property, and other neighbors in this section supplying water supply to lots 4, 5, and 6. If this is true, there is no doubt that there, through this other access, that there is wetlands that Dr. Sullivan has already pointed out. But I can tell you behind my house and probably a third of the lot abutting the Baldock's property is underwater essentially year-round. Despite the dry summers we had, we usually have about 6 inches of water in that area. And this also is true up to our line and beyond our line abutting Mr. Kennedy's properties. And again, this is also true for the Pierces throughout that whole section. So he would be needing to excavate quite a bit of wetlands in order to place in that new water access. And again, just to reiterate what has really been said, I don't understand why he cannot go from Winding Way right up the road that he's cleared and has excavated at certain times in the year. That's really all I have to say.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public? Okay, thank you. As previously discussed, we'll keep the public hearing open until the next meeting, but curtail this further discussion this evening. With that, any further discussion by the board?
Yes, I have to say that I was not present at the last planning board meeting, and for, so I don't know the latest developments, but I did, was on the planning board at the time that this application came through the first time around, and I'm quite disturbed, frankly, to hear the suggestion tonight that the site has been as poorly cared for as it apparently has been. And I guess I have two suggestions, one of which is that I do take very seriously the requirements of the planning board, and I also take very seriously the sense that if we're going to spend the time that we spend trying to guard and safeguard the interests of the town, that I want the requirements of the planning board set forth in approvals to be honored thereafter. And with that in mind, I would suggest that perhaps, I don't know whether it's appropriate, I know what the site used to look like, I live now in another part of town, I haven't frankly seen it lately. And I'm disturbed enough by what I hear tonight to suggest that perhaps we want to do a sidewalk and we want to see what it looks like and we want to find out, I guess what I would be thinking would be if the site is as portrayed tonight, I would be willing to suggest and entertain and probably push for a motion that says before anything else gets done, we get some real sense of what's going to be cleaned up. And again, if it's as bad as I say as it's been suggested tonight, that I would like to hear from the town manager about why the letter of credit has not been pulled. Because the letter of credit was a requirement that was supposed to secure the applicant's promises to do what the applicant proposed in the application. And the whole reason for a letter of credit is to play, not play, to be able to provide, quote unquote, an incentive to an applicant to abide by the applicant's promises. And I'm quite serious about, I don't, I think I've probably said enough.
I don't recall the time limit placed on that issue other than the 1 year that was mentioned, but I guess I'm getting a bit uncomfortable in terms of getting into a lot of discussion on this application this evening. I think we've let the public...
I guess my point in talking, excuse me for interrupting, was to find out whether there was any other interest by other members of the planning board in a sidewalk.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Carlson.
We did discuss about a sidewalk at one time and at one of our previous meetings, and it was agreed that then we'd do it on an individual basis, as I recall.
That was my record.
And that's the reason I was up there. In fact, I've been up there two or three or four times. It's a good walk, for one thing, and second, with all the material that we've been getting in the mail, I wanted to see it again. So we did discuss a sidewalk, and maybe you were not at that meeting, but possibly all the other members have seen that. I don't want to have the planning board, people thinking the planning board has not seen the site. I think a majority of us might have. Thank you.
Yeah, I also want to keep clear the issue of enforcement versus the responsibility of the planning board to review and deal with applicants this way. Even if we were on the site and we identified all the issues that are outstanding and the description, I think, is... as the public's presented this evening is probably pretty accurate to what's out there, that even if we were to bring that into this review process, there's already a mechanism in place for enforcement of the issues that need to be dealt with on the site, as I understand it. That's the letter of credit or the bond that's outstanding and that's been extended. I don't know if we'd have any further assurances that if we make as a condition of approval, again, we're getting into too much discussion here, but if we were to bring any of those enforcement issues into the next review of the application, other than to say that we're not going to review anything until the site's cleaned up according to the bond, but that I think is it's a bigger issue than just the planning board. I think the town manager's name's been mentioned, code enforcement certainly is an issue, and the correspondence that we have in the file today suggests that the town manager is in favor of amending the letter of credit, drawing it down, or lowering the, according to the information that the town engineer has provided, that is of the improvements that are already in place. There's no mention about calling it or any further enforcement action in that letter.
I understand that, and I guess what I'm suggesting is that I understand the town manager's conclusions, but I don't understand the town manager's thought processes, and I would be requesting, as one board member, more elucidation on that score.
Certainly appropriate. Any other? How would you like that? Would you like that? Excuse me just a minute. Would you like that through a letter from the town manager, or are you suggesting it'd be appropriate for his to attend at the workshop?
Up to the town manager.
Through the chair. Mm-hmm. The manager was planning on attending tonight's meeting until he found out that the applicant had requested that it be tabled.
Okay, good. Perhaps then either through your discussions with him, he can enlighten us further as to the issues of enforcement. There was a member of the public who had raised his hand. The public has had an opportunity to speak. I don't want to jeopardize the proceedings any further by making this into a debate or protracting the discussions this evening. The applicant isn't here. I think the public has made their message very clear. I certainly heard everything very clearly and took some good mental notes. What I'd like to do is to get to the issue of the proposed motion. And be reminded that the public hearing remains open. We have had an issue of discussion with respect to a site walk. Do any members of the planning board, would they like to have the planning board meet and walk the site together? Or would you prefer just simply to go to the site as we already have individually?
I've been to the site in the last couple of weeks. I was there again today. And the descriptions are pretty complete.
And I, from what I hear, it would also seem that there may be issues with respect to the DEP enforcement here, not just the town. And I guess that would be a question as well.
I think you made the comment that it's important that the planning board is reminded what our responsibilities are, and we are either to approve, deny, or table this. And the enforcement issue that's come up before really isn't our jurisdiction.
I disagree, because I think that there are ways in which we need to understand how it is that the requirements that we are imposing are going to be honored. And part of what would be important to me the second time around would be to know how my requirements were interpreted the first time around. I'm quite clear that I'm not the enforcer, but I am also clear that part of my decision making has to do with how our suggestions were understood and our requirements were understood the first time around.
Mr. Carl.
Mr. Chair, I question the motion as far as if the applicant feels like not coming again in December. What does the board do in that case? Do we continue to hold it open to when he wants to come in, or do we put a condition in that if he doesn't show, he has to reapply, or how does that all work? We might very well find out that he doesn't want to come December 19th.
Well, I'll ask Maureen to answer the question, but it would be my best judgment that the applicant, the tabling motion is with the understanding that the applicant intends fully to complete some of the corrections that were referenced in the engineer's report. The letter does have a reference to their change in schedule with respect to missing this meeting, but there's nothing in that letter that I think rests with the responsibility of staff or this board. I think the issues that need to be addressed are self-evident. And as an old friend used to say, I won't even get into it. There's a phrase for the issue at hand that I won't use. I think everyone on the board may know what it is.
That's tantalizing.
Maureen, do you want to give us a little insight on the issue of tabling and then not having the applicant proceed in earnest with the application?
Well, once you deem the application complete, the clock starts ticking for the board. So it's a live application that has pending status. For that reason, I would recommend that the board not leave an open application sitting indefinitely. So, you know, you can table it tonight, you may even table it in a month, but at some point, I would think you would want to end it one way or the other.
We have that option, then?
Oh, yes.
No, actually, it's not an option. We have to have a finding within the 60 days.
Right. And the ordinance says if you want to table it beyond 60 days, you need to have the consent of the applicant.
Thank you.
I don't know if we need to discuss that any further, but my general sense of the board this evening is that this board wants this applicant back before us as soon as possible, and this application completed and addressed accordingly. The board will act as required, as necessary.
I have a motion.
Yes. Okay.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered, that based on the plans and materials submitted, the application of Portland Development Group for a wetlands alteration permit for the location of a water line in the Highland subdivision located in the vicinity of Jordan Farm Road, Winding Way, and Hunts Point Road Extension, and an amendment to a previously approved subdivision, be tabled to the regular December the 19th, 1995 meeting of the Planning Board.
Have a motion. Second?
Second.
Any discussion on the motion?
Is the applicant Portland Development or Peter Kennedy?
Portland Development Group is what I understood.
Well, the latest headings we're having on any correspondence just says Peter Kennedy, and there is no, the original applicant was Portland Development Group. I'm not sure that they're still involved.
Steve Moore wrote recently and said on behalf of Peter Kennedy of Portland Development Group, so I thought it was just an informal way to refer to the Portland Development. Why don't we just say, well, the applicant's application? I'm easy tonight. Whatever makes the most sense. Do you want to say Peter Kennedy?
I don't mind saying both. Doesn't it? It should just be clear.
Peter Kennedy and or Portland Development Group.
There you go. And what was the provision for the public hearing in the motion?
Be tabled? Oh, there was I'd also amend the motion to suggest that the public hearing, which was, well, I guess that's
open.
Already, no, but that's, we don't need a motion for that. I think that Tom has already...
It remains open.
It's he has declared it open, so we don't need to do anything further to affect that.
For clarity, it would be with the understanding that the public hearing continues to be opened at the next meeting, and that the abutters will be re-notified. For clarification, there was not a specific reference to the applicant's request for tabling in your motion.
Said materials submitted.
I don't care whether we refer to it or not. It's my suggestion that we table it.
Okay. I think that we should also amend the motion to specifically reference the applicant's request in the letter dated November 21st, 1995 to Thomas Emery, Chair of the Planning Board, from Stephen Moore, asking that this evening's item be tabled.
I'll accept that amendment.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion as amended? Passes unanimously. Thank you very much for coming this evening. Next item under new business on this evening's agenda. Could I ask that you please hold your discussions outside the chambers? Thank you. Okay. Next item under new business on tonight's agenda is Main Wireless Antennas and Utility Building. Maureen, would you give us a little background on this?
Main Wireless is proposing to add two antennas and a new utility building to an existing tower, which is approximately 180 feet high and located at 351 Spurwink Ave. The site is located in the RP3 zone due to steep slopes. For that reason, it needs an RP3 permit, and it also needs site plan review. The board deemed the application complete at the last meeting, and under the RP3 permit requirements, must hold a public hearing, which has been scheduled for this evening. After the public hearing, the board has the option to move forward with the application. I should let you know that I have received a few calls from people. Most of their comments surrounded that they had no opposition because it was on an existing tower.
Thank you.
They didn't have any position at all, either yea or nay?
They were very concerned about it until they found out that the antennas were going to be attached to an existing tower, and at that point, they no longer were concerned about the impact.
That's good.
Any questions?
No, it would be appropriate. There aren't a lot of members of the public here other than those who have direct interest. If you could just give us an overview of any changes and an update for the public record, and then we'll open it for a public hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with Sebago Technics. Here with me tonight is Doug Edwards, Director of Operations at Main Wireless. Since our meeting in October 17th, the board requested a couple of items that we follow up on. One was to evaluate the potential noise from the generator unit. The second item was that the board asked the town's legal counsel to review the issue of two issues. One had to do with the lease agreement between Main Cellular and Main Wireless, and the second had to do with setbacks. Did the setbacks, should you measure setbacks from the lease lot line or the actual property lines of the parcel? And I think I'll start with the board. I'll go back and start with the noise, and then we can move to the other one. What we did was Doug Edwards, we had him contact Canfield Communications of Scarborough, who provided Doug with a calibrated sound meter. And what we did was to gain a representative or a more accurate picture of what the sound would be like. Doug Edwards took the sound meter and went to an existing Main Cellular site with similar physical conditions. And what he did was at different intervals moving away from a similar generator unit was to actually take field readings of the sound to try to develop a chart that would show you what the sound was going to be like as you moved away from the facility. And his report is included in your submittal package along with an 8.5 by 11 sketch that I prepared. And basically what that sketch shows is the generator location. It also shows a perimeter which is a 650-foot radius. And what that represents is in the field, what Doug measured was a background, I'll call it a background or a base sound level of about 40 decibels. Due to wind and natural occurring noise within the forest. So that's kind of a ground elevation. We labeled that as the audible limit. In other words, the point of you couldn't tell the difference between the generator and the background noise. And that is about 650 feet from the generator. Because the parcel itself is so extensive, the north and south boundaries are completely contained within Mr. Strout's site. The easterly boundary is Spurwink Avenue, and the westerly boundary measurement was taken at 51 decibels. Actually, that was a projected noise level of 51 decibels. Doug took measurements out to 200 feet and then projected the noise level out to 650 feet. And at the property line on that side would be 51 decibels. To tell you what that means, we included a chart which kind of summarizes what sound levels would be. And this is an EPA chart that Doug Edwards acquired. And basically, the 51 decibels would equate to a small town or quiet suburban setting. The 40 decibels is somewhere between, somewhere around a quiet tomato field or farm. So that's what they say the 40 decibels is. So basically, that chart progresses upwards to 90 decibels, which gets up to freeways and loud city noise and that sort of thing. So we're down on the lower end of the chart towards the quiet suburban setting. Doug had his Jeep Cherokee up there, which is a 1995 Jeep Cherokee, and took some noise readings at that. And I think, if I remember correctly, at 140 feet, at 50 feet, see, the measurement shown that the idling Jeep at 50 feet had about the same effect as the generator at 320 feet. So vehicles are fairly quiet. So that's really the extent of the noise. I guess if you were to try to qualify it in terms of what 51 decibels means, it's a quiet suburban setting. And that is just at the one property line, which would be, over here. Mm-hmm. The rest of the site is very long, a few thousand feet long, so it's all completely contained in the site. And of course, down here is Spurwink Avenue, and by the time you get down there, the noise traffic is noise from traffic will be greater. So that was the results of that analysis. The second item that the board asked us, or not really asked us to do, it was they contacted the town's legal counsel, was to review the two issues on the setbacks and the lease. Basically, as I read what the town's legal counsel interpreted the ordinance to mean, was that the setback should be measured from the physical property boundaries, in other words, Mr. Strout's exterior property lines, and not the 100 by 100 lease area. The second item had to do with the signing of a lease between Maine Cellular and Maine Wireless. And I believe Doug Edwards submitted a letter to Maureen that was signed by Doug Edwards, indicating, I think, what the attorneys wanted to within the letter. And that, I think, brings us up to date. And Doug's here, so we'll be glad to answer any questions that the board would have. Thank you.
Thank you. Any immediate questions from the board?
Do we have to open the public hearing?
I was going to do that before we open the public hearing. Okay. Seeing none, I'll open the public hearing. Any members of the public who wish to present either in favor or against the project?
not even in jest.
Nothing. Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Any further discussions or questions from the board? Mr. Edsel?
No. I just had one very minor question. When will this be operational if it's approved this evening?
Approximately the 1st of February.
Mr. Edsel?
My first question is of Maureen, the planner. The original Maine Cellular approval, was there any condition there that more antennas? I mean, we're not contradicting any condition of the original approval to Maine Cellular?
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Yeah, I have to apologize a little bit. The last meeting we had, I didn't have a copy of the letter from Maine Cellular.
If I could interrupt you, yeah. What happened is in your original application, you submitted the Maine Cellular letter, and you picked up all the materials. I kept my copy, and you took everything back. And when you resubmitted, you left out the Maine Cellular letter. That's why I think there was some confusion, and I made sure they got it in their last package. So,
The issue that I was going to bring up is I didn't understand at the time that it's a non-exclusive lease. In other words, Maine Wireless is not leasing all of Maine Cellular's interest on this site, which... The reason I asked the question about any condition in the original approval was that Maine Cellular has the right, if they don't, to add 10, 12, you know, fill the entire tower structure, which my reading, originally I did read the Maine Cellular approval several weeks ago, was actually the tone of the board at the time, they'd rather keep more antenna on one tower structure than multiple towers. The issue of, I'm satisfied with the legal response, or the opinion from town legal counsel. It does bring up an issue. It, in essence, states that the site for this application really is the 31-acre site, not the 10,000-square-foot leasehold interest, in lots of different ways. Which brings up the issue of, there are three other tower structures on the site. At what height do all towers have to be, tower structures have to be approved by the planning board?
Any tower structure would have to be approved by the planning board because it's a structure. At least that's my understanding of how the code officer handles it.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't speak for the code officer. He's the one that officially in the ordinance has the authority to refer things to the planning board. He decides whether or not it's something that requires planning board review or doesn't. And to your first question, even if there was a condition on the Maine Cellular application that wouldn't allow additional antennas, you would be able to amend it by this application.
Even though Maine Cellular is not the applicant here?
They're not the applicant, but it's the same site and
no, but it's not. That's the issue with this application, that the lease really is just for one building and 20 feet of tower space.
But they're not officially the applicant, but they are a knowledgeable and willing party.
Okay. A point of clarification, you know, I certainly will accept the revised letter of intent here is right title and interest, but in that it says that the antenna, the lease will be at the 140, 160 foot level. I think the site plan indicates that the antenna are at the 160 and above level. I mention that only because we have the or Maine Cellular has the option of, again, putting as many antenna on here with other lessors as they may choose. So we might as well have the record straight with the site plan that's the portion that you're leasing, and that coincides with the lease itself.
I think the intent was that the top would not go above 160 feet.
It's right. That's a typo.
It is above 160.
Right.
The
space that we will have available is 140 to 160.
All I'm saying is that should match on the site plan, which on my copy it doesn't. It's that space above.
Yeah, if we could.
Hey, excuse me, Steve. You're requesting that on the elevation they state specifically that the.
Well, in the lease it states, in the lease from, or the letter of intent from, which establishes their right title and interest from Maine Cellular to Maine Wireless, but it doesn't say specifically, but I read that to them, that they're leasing them that space on the tower from the 140 to 160 level. And it's simply the plan. It shows it above that.
It's an error on the plan. We will amend it.
It's an error in that it shows the vertical members being above the 160 elevation.
In other words, if Maine Cellular wants to come in and rent the 160 to 170 spot on the tower, and then we might as well have the plans in place if we're approving site plans, that it's correct.
We would certainly be willing to, to show what I should do is show a 140 to 160 and just indicate that that's the window that the tower could be in, and I can submit a revised plan to Maureen for a record. So.
In fact, the 160 foot level clear up to the top, actually over the top, is occupied.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're already there. Question, only because when I was going to that site this afternoon, there was an aircraft going directly overhead. And maybe you can answer this question. At what height does it become necessary to have a beacon, a light, flashing light on the tower?
The simple answer to that is 200 feet. It's more complex than that. What we have to do is a filing with the FAA and there's some formulas where we have to state the distance to the end of the nearest active runway of the nearest airport, and there's certain airport classifications, and depending upon the size of the airport, that imaginary line is different. That site is far enough away from the jetport that the tower is 180, it's probably 195 to the tip of the antennas, and I would guess, and there's no lighting required.
It's 200 feet of height of the tower or elevation?
200 feet above existing terrain.
So if it's on a 2,000-foot mountain, you could have a 200-foot...
You could have a 195-foot tower on top of a 2,000-foot mountain, and it doesn't need to be lit.
I understand that. Okay. That's all I have.
Thank you. Any further questions or discussion?
Yes.
Ms. McKay?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I understood, I'm addressing the issue of the ownership interest by the applicant, and I understood that the town council recommended that the applicant would demonstrate sufficient interest to support the application if Maine Wireless were to sign the August the 30th letter. Has that been done, and did I miss it?
It should be on the podium tonight.
Ah. Okay.
Actually, you have two letters. There was some concern on Maureen's part that the board wanted an original document. So I signed the original letter of intent, as it appeared to me that the town attorneys wanted, and I also provided an original copy of a letter to Maine Cellular specifically agreeing to the terms and conditions. So take your pick.
Thank you. That's all I had. I have a motion if someone else doesn't.
I just have, I could deal with this as a motion, but. Did you have a?
I just had a motion to make.
Before you make the motion, I just want to follow up with Steve's question about any restrictions with respect to additional antennas on this tower. I wasn't on the board when this was approved. One hears things around town, you know, that there was a big commotion with the first antenna that went on this tower, and whether it was going to be one tower or multiple towers. But one always has a sort of nagging feeling that something may have been placed on the application as originally approved that would have restricted more than a certain number of antennas. Are you drawing from recollection that there's no restriction on that? Or I'd be very happy as part of the motion just simply to have Maureen review the file so that the applicant isn't caught either, you know, just to be sure that the record's clear on that issue.
Go run up and get it.
I don't want to take the time now, but.
Wouldn't it be safe to assume that the applicant's attorney probably has reviewed that formal approval for the first time to make sure that they are not in violation?
No. Not.
Actually.
Perhaps in this specific case it may be, but in general I would say no. I don't assume anything. It's the most obvious thing to tend to surprise one.
My initial inquiry to the town when we first started this project was to have a meeting with Mr. McVain, and he got out all the files and went through and looking for these kinds of things, and he came to the conclusion based on, I think, the motion. He had a record of the minutes where the original project was approved, and there were no limitations of that type that were in there.
Okay. Ms. McKay.
I just have one more question, and that is, what relationship do you have to Maine Wireless Limited Partnership? Are you a general partner?
I'm the director of engineering and operations.
Are you a partner, or are you an employee?
I am an employee.
Okay. Traditionally, the general partner or a general partner of a limited partnership is the one who has the duty to, the right, shall we say, to bind the limited partnership. But if you are a, who is the general partner of Maine Wireless Limited Partnership?
Maine State Cellular.
A corporation?
It's a corporation, president of which is Tim Hutchison.
Okay. And who are the officers of the
of the corporation?
Let's see. I am once a year. I think I'm a treasurer this year, but...
Good. I hope so.
And I'm on the board of, I'm on the board of directors.
Fine. You have enough, you have apparent authority as far as I'm concerned to buy the limited partnership, so I'm not going to inquire any further.
Thank you.
The same question came to me, and I thought I'd be too picky to bring it up, because everybody was frowning on all my questions. We don't know whether, is it Dane Somers or Rain Somers is an officer of Maine Cellular, or has the authority to...
He's the general manager. What positions he holds beyond that, I don't know.
Just typically, when you see a letter of intent with some seen and agreed to language to it, both people who sign, both sign their signature, their name is typed so you can read it, number two, your level of authority to actually bind whoever you're binding to that agreement. And this does neither.
That's true, Stephen. You have a very good point. But since it's on Maine Cellular letterhead, that lends a great deal of credence to the fact that at least it comes from someone who has apparent authority to use the letterhead. So that's half of it. And then if we can get Mr. Edwards to testify with respect to the other half, I think we've got it made.
I'd rather have an attorney say that than me.
I have stopped publishing these days. I have to agree wholeheartedly. I would like to thank my fellow board members for being very thorough in this instance. It's, you may think that you're being picky, but I'm quite impressed with the thoroughness that you've reviewed the application.
I'll ask one more question. Since
you've left, don't encourage it too much.
Are there leases involved with any of the other three antennas on the property? In other words, does anybody have a leasehold interest in any of the other three?
Well,
antennas
speaking
on the site.
From Maine Wireless, we do not.
No, I'm actually from Mr. Strout, I believe. Are there, do you lease any of those antennas to other parties?
The tower that you're dealing with here?
Yes, or the other three, are there any of the other
the
three?
Leasing out to those various people, yes. Well, that's been ongoing since 1946.
The issue I'm getting at is a subdivision issue, whether you have by leasehold interest a subdivision. And I didn't even want to bring it up, but I did.
I just popped the temperature.
Good question.
Because our legal counsel is basically stated that the site before us for review is the 31-acre site. It gains that by, in other words, this site does not have any, or just a very minor amount of slope that's in there, qualifies it for RP. It takes that 31 acre.
But having no other information before me other than the fact that he's been putting these towers up and leasing rights from the tower since 1947, for it to be a subdivision, I think he would have had to lease the pieces out.
In
the last 5 years.
That's right. But that's what I didn't know, was if any of the leases were... the Maine Cellular lease is not within the last 5 years. So. And this lease does not constitute, the lease with Maine Wireless does not constitute another lease. That's a sub-lessor to an existing lease. But it was the town council or legal council that indicated that we have two different definitions for lot, one under the zoning ordinance and one on the subdivision. And it's only under this lot definition does it bring up limiting it to the fee simple boundaries. I don't think it's an issue here. It could very well be an issue in other sites, and I think that's a workshop issue we need to deal with. No more. We're done.
Did Mr. Parkhurst
have a motion for the board to consider? Excuse me. Findings of fact. Number one, Maine Wireless is requesting approval to add two antennas to the existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Ave and to add a second utility building to the base of the tower. Number two, the application substantially complies with site plan review section 19-2-10 and an RP3 permit section 19-3-9 and section 6-6-3. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Maine Wireless for site plan review and an RP3 permit for two antennas in a utility building for an existing tower located at 351 Spurwink Ave be approved with the following condition, provided the plan accurately depicts that the leased tower space, accurately depicts the leased tower space at the 140 to 160-foot levels.
I'll second the motion.
Second. Further discussion? I had suggested that it would be appropriate for me to check the record. The applicant has stated for the record that he did so with a code enforcement officer. I will request outside the motion that Maureen just checks, just so that everyone's covered, but I don't think it needs to be part of the motion. Okay, we have, any further discussion on the motion? All those in favor indicate by raising right hand. Passes unanimously. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Beginning to think it might be bad luck putting it over.
Squeak by this time.
This is, what is this, just a duplication of what's there?
Well, yeah, but what's... No, we're just going to add right one more set of horizontals, and this should say 140.
Would you make a motion for adjournment?
No, I'm getting it. It's one more station.
Yes.
Second.
Right, there's two, add one more pair.
Excuse me?
Owens.
Sorry.
Mr. Edwards, there's a microphone right overhead there, so any discussions, you're on TV until we close the meeting. Motion to adjourn?
Been done.
Second. Oh, it has, second. All those in favor? Meeting's adjourned.
Can someone consult Robert's rules of order and see if we actually need a motion for adjournment?
Good night, Steve.
I was always under the impression that once you declared that all of the...